Back to another lecture of Dental Pachala, where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy. When today's video is a continuation of Express Revision course of orthodontics, and today's video we are going to talk about the removable and fixed orthodontics. Before we get started, make sure to subscribe to the channel and click on the bell icon so that you don't miss any of our future videos. So guys, let's start with the removable and the fixed orthodontics. As we know that the first orthodontic appliance was given by Perry Fortier, right? And the appliance which he gave was known as the Bandelate appliance. And as we know guys, that this is a Hawley's retainer, right? In the Hawley's retainer, we have got labial bow as well as the Adam's clasp here. Adam's clasp. So Hawley's retainer, we know that was given by Hawley. Also the labial bow was also given by Charles Hawley. Now removable appliance has got three components. As you can see here in the Hawley's retainer removable appliance, there are three components to a removable appliance. So we have got three components. One is a retentive component, which is basically our clasp. As you can see here, we have Adam's clasp in the Hawley's retainer. Another one is the active component, right, which is the labial bow in the Hawley's. So, and the third component we have is the base plate. As you can see, pink color acrylic plate is our base plate. So we have got three components of a removable appliance: a retentive component, active component and a base plate. Now talking about the most commonly used clasp. So the first one we have here is the circumferential clasp, guys. As it is surrounding the circumference of the tooth, and also we have studied the circumference clasp in the prosto as well, right? So this is a circumferential clasp. So guys, as you can see in this diagram over here, this circumferential clasp is encircling the tooth. So this is a tooth, and here we have a circumferential clasp which is encircling the tooth, more than 180 degrees of the tooth, right? And that usually contacts the tooth throughout the extent of the clasp. So this is the circumferential clasp. Next one guys we have is a Jackson's clasp. So this is a Jackson's clasp. And guys, this Jackson clasp was given by Jackson, and it is fabricated using 0.9 millimeter wire. And this Jackson clasp is also known as a full clasp. As you can see in the diagram over here, that this clasp is a full clasp, right? So it is giving more of the retention, or because as you can see here, this is U in shape. So this is a molar, and we have this Jackson clasp which is kind of a U shape, right? So that is why we call it a U shape clasp also. So a U shape clasp. So guys, this Jackson clasp engages both the bucco cervical undercuts and it offers a good retention. But we cannot give this clasp in a partially erupted teeth, because we want to engage in both the undercuts, the bucco cervical undercuts. So guys, next one we have, as you can see in the diagram over here, Adam's clasp. And we know that this Adam's clasp was given by Dr. C. Philip Adams, and this is also known as a modified arrowhead clasp. A modified, because this is the shape of the clasp is arrowhead in shape. So this is also known as a modified arrowhead clasp. And also, because this clasp was developed at the Liverpool Dental School, where Phillips Adams was a lecturer. So that is why we also call it the Liverpool clasp. And this clasp engages the mesiobuccal and the distobuccal undercut. If you can see here, it engages the mesiobuccal and the distobuccal undercut of the tooth, and mostly it is used for the maxillary first molar for the retention purposes. And it is usually made up of 0.7 millimeter stainless steel wire. So guys, next clasp we have is the south end clasp. So this is a south end clasp. So south end clasp, the wire is adapted along the cervical margins of the both central incisor. If you can see here, these are the two central incisors, and a wire is adapted along the cervical margins of the two central incisors, and the distal ends are carried over the occlusal embrasure on the palatal side. So they will be going on the palatal sides as the retentive arms. So it is helpful in giving retention in the anterior region. So it is more aesthetic clasp. The next clasp we have is a triangular clasp. As you can see, the shape of this clasp is more of a triangular in shape. So this is a triangular clasp. Now this triangular clasp engages the proximal undercut of the two teeth. So in between it is going and engaging into the proximal undercut, and the best part of this clasp is that it doesn't cause any irritation of the gingiva, right? So we use this clasp when there is an additional retention is required. So it provides excellent retention to the tooth. The next clasp we have is a Schwartz clasp. So this is a Schwartz clasp, which we also call it the arrowhead clasp, because if you can see here, the shape is arrow. So this is the head of a arrow. So we also call it the arrowhead clasp. And this Schwartz clasp, guys, is designed by the person named as C.M. Schwartz. And this arrowhead bend is towards the papillary region. So if you can see here, this part is the buccal part and it is going into the papilla. So this arrow is into the papillary region. So guys, this arrow is into the papillary region. So these are the two teeth, and this arrow goes into the papillary region of the teeth to engage into the undercut. So it can be used for the deciduous as well as for the permanent teeth. And the next clasp we have is a Crozet clasp. So this is a Crozet clasp. Now this Crozet clasp is more like a full clasp, but there is an additional piece of wire, if you can see here, it is soldered, which engage into the distal and the proximal undercut area. So guys, this is a Crozet clasp. Now guys, we know that these clasps are made up of stainless steel wire, and one of the main concept that we consider while doing the wire bending is that the diameter of the wire and the length of the wire. So this is the diameter of the wire and the length of the wire. So the forces which are generated or which are applied by a wire, we have a formula for that, that is directly proportional to d raised to power 4 and divided by l raised to power 3. So this is the formula we have, and if we conclude according to this formula, that means suppose, also there is a question which is asked frequently. So suppose, for example, if we double the diameter, right, so what will happen to the forces? So the if you calculate from this formula, so if you double the diameter, that means the forces which are applied are 16 times, right? So decreasing the diameter, also will lead to decreasing in the forces. So also there is a one more thing, that is the flexibility. If the diameter is more, that means the wire is thicker. So the forces which are applied are greater, but the flexibility of the wire, it decreases, right? And we have, if the diameter is less, that means the wire is thin, so forces applied are less and the spring remains more flexible and it is active over a longer or a larger period of time. So we have, let's talk about some of the clasp or some of the wire component, and along with that, which wire do we use for these components, because that is sometimes a question which is asked frequently. So guys, the first one we will be talking about is the Z spring. The wire which we use for Z spring is 0.5 millimeter of wire, which is the thinnest wire, and we have just now studied that lesser the diameter of the thin wire, That means if we decrease the diameter of the wire, the forces applied are lesser and the wire remains more flexible. So that means the Z spring is more flexible, right? And next one we'll be talking about is the Adams clasp. We have already covered about the Adams clasp, which is also known as the modified arrowhead clasp, and it is made up of 0.7 millimeter of wire. Also, we have studied that the labial bow is also constructed from a 0.7 millimeter of stainless steel wire. Now, next one is the lip bumper. So, lip bumper is constructed from thicker wire, that is 0.9 millimeter of wire. And the coffin spring, if you remember in the maxillary expansion, slow maxillary expansion, the palatal wire which we give like this one, right? If you remember, and it is going to make these lateral halves move. So that is how it will help in the maxillary expansion, slow maxillary expansion. So this coffin spring is made up of 1.25 millimeter wire, and also in the preclinical ortho we have also made all these things. So we have already used these wires for making all these wire components. So next, talking about guys, about angle, right? Edward angle. So we know that angle, Edward angle is a father of orthodontics, right? He is the father of modern orthodontics, and he developed few fixed appliances, right? One of them is E-arch appliance. This was the first appliance which Edward gave, so that is why E-arch appliance, because Edward angle. And he constructed a rigid U-shaped framework around the dental arch. This framework is inserted into the bands which are placed on the first molar region, right? So he constructed these U-shaped framework all around the arch, and he inserted this U-shaped framework into the bands which are placed on the molar. And the end of the wire was threaded so that it can move anteriorly. So each tooth was ligated to this metal framework so that the dental arch can be expanded or dental arch can be aligned. Next of his discovery was pinen tube. Now this is, pinen tube was not a very famous discovery, so it had a lot of drawbacks. So this appliance was also given by the angle, of course, and it consisted of some bands on each tooth which was soldered to a vertical tube. So then the pins soldered on the arch wires were inserted into these tubes to bring about the tooth movement. And you know what, this pinen tube was perfectly used only by the angle himself. So this was a major fallback for the angle of one of his appliances. And also the same happens with the ribbon arch appliance. So a ribbon arch appliance, because of its flexibility, so it had a poor control in the root positioning, so it was not used much appliances. Now this ribbon arch appliances, it consists of brackets with the vertical slots which are oriented incisally. And the last one we'll be talking about in the angles, Edward angle appliances, the edgewise appliance. So the edgewise appliance consist of the ribbon arch system, which has a vertical slot, but it does not provide a good control over the tooth movement. So to overcome this, angle reoriented the slot from the vertical. Now till here he was using the vertical slots, but now that because of so much of drawback, so much of fallback in all of his appliances, now he switched to horizontal. So the insertion of the wire was rotated to 90 degrees in case of a ribbon arch, and now that he was using the horizontal. So this time the tooths, the slot sizes was 0.022 into 0.028 inches and 0.018 into 0.025 inches. So basically this edgewise system, he gave three types of bending for the tooth movement. So there were three bendings. first bend we know that is always for the alignment of the tooth, right? So the first order bend, this is the horizontal bend, or we can say in and out bend, or the facio-labial lingual bends, right? To compensate for the contouring of the labial surfaces. So suppose this is the labial surface which is not properly aligned. So this is for the contouring of the labial surface. Suppose here we have one teeth, here we have another incisor. This is an incisor view, if you can see here. So for the alignment of the teeth, this is the first order bend. Now then he told we have to give the second order bend. So second order bend are the angles bend, right, which bring about mesiodistal root movement. The third order bend in the edgewise system is the labio-lingual root bends, so which will bring about the torquing movements of the root. So this is about the edgewise system. Next, a student of the angle, Edward Angle, he gave an appliance which is the Begg's appliance. So he saw that so many drawbacks Angle is coming up with, and he modified this ribbon arch appliance and gave his Begg's appliance. So now what he did, Raymond Begg, he is a student of Angle, he modified the Edward Angle's ribbon arch system. If you see, he has given the ribbon arch appliance. So he modified this, the Begg modified this appliance, and the arch wire is changed from precious metal to the stainless steel. And also, if you remember, if you remember the ribbon arch appliance, it had a vertical slot, right? So this is the ribbon arch. And the Begg's appliance, he changed it from incisal to gingival. So various auxiliaries were also used to control the root. Now the third one we have is the straight wire appliance. This straight wire appliance was developed by Andrews. So in the straight wire appliance, there are different bends given in the edgewise appliance which are compensated in the bracket itself. So in a straight wire appliance, a rectangular straight wire, so this wire is a rectangular wire which the Andrews used for the straight wire appliance, which brings the proper positioning of the tooth when the wire is passive in the bracket slot. So in the straight wire appliance, the first order bend is to compensate in the bracket base itself. Second order bend is compensated by angulating the bracket or the slot of the bracket. And the third order bend is compensated by inclining the bracket slot. So that the third order bend need not to be given. So the most common prescription of the straight wire appliance used is MBT, and these are the name of the McLaughlin, Bennett and Trevisi, which we do not have to remember. So what are the components of a fixed orthodontic appliance? We have the passive components. So in the passive component, there are brackets, right? These brackets can be made up of metal or they can be made up of ceramic. We know that metal makes a good bond, right? Ceramics, on the other hand, is brittle, but it bond chemically. So also we have buccal and lingual tubes, buccal and lingual tubes. So these are basically the molar tube, which has a slot for the arch wire, so that we can pass these arch wires through these slots. So the dimensions of the buccal tube is 0.022 into 0.028 inches. And in the maxilla we have double tube. So the buccal tube, in the maxilla we have the double tube. In the maxilla is the double tube. That means there are two slots. One for rectangular and one for the round. So guys, these are the passive component. Active component in the fixed appliance, we have the wires, then we have the elastics, we have the springs, right, the open and the closed coil spring, then we have e-chains, implants, head gears. Also there can be one more slot in the buccal tube for the head gear. So guys, we are covering only important points. We are going a bit faster so that we can cover only high yielding points in this video. So next, talking about, as you can see in the diagram, we have anterior bite plane. Anterior bite plane, right? If you can see here, there is a bite which is present only in the anterior region. So if you can make out, this bite is there only in the anterior region. So we use it for the case of the deep bite. So we use it for the deep bite patients. So guys, what happens when we give anterior bite plane? So it is going, the anterior teeth are going to occlude with each other, and in the posterior region you can see there is a separation of the posterior teeth. So there is a disocclusion at the posterior teeth, so there is a separation, the teeth are not occluding by 2 to 3 millimeters. So there is a basically gap created in the posterior region, so the posterior teeth erupts in this gap. And once this posterior teeth erupts, now suppose there is a gap, what happens when these posterior teeth erupts? So when these posterior teeth are going to erupt, come in occlusion, then there is going to be a gap in the anterior region, and this is what we want to treat. We want to treat the deep bite. So because there is a gap created later on at the anterior region, so this deep bite is corrected. The opposite of this happens with the posterior bite plane. So in case of a posterior bite plane, suppose these are the molars, and guys, what happens when you give a posterior bite plane? So you are giving a bite plane at the posterior tooth region, right? So once you give a bite to the posterior tooth region, the same happens, that there is going to be a disocclusion, or there is going to be a gap at the anterior region. So the anterior tooth supra erupts. When you are giving a bite plane at the posterior region, there is a separation at the anterior tooth region. So this is a posterior bite plane. A posterior bite plane. Now what happens? There is going to be disocclusion of the anterior tooth region, and this is how we correct the anterior cross bite. So correction of anterior cross bite. Very important point, guys. For deep bite, we give the anterior bite plane, and for anterior cross bite we give the posterior bite plane. So guys, posterior bite plane used for anterior cross bite correction, and anterior bite plane for deep bite correction, right? So next one we have is the Catalan's appliance. So if you can see here that there is a lower inclined plane, right? So on the lower teeth, so there is a 45 degree angulation constructed, if you can see here, 45 degrees at the lower anterior teeth. I have shown you with an acrylic, but there can also be a cast metal. So this Ketelin appliance is made on the lower anterior tooth region, and where it is used? In a cross bite. So it is used in a cross bite. Whenever there are palatally placed maxillary incisors, we use the Ketelin appliance, or we can say the lower anterior inclined plane. The next one we have is the Suede appliance. If you can see here, this one we have is the Suede appliance. So Suede appliance is an upper inclined plane. Ketelin's appliance is a lower inclined plane. So Ketelin's appliance is used only in the cases where there is a cross bite, which is due to the maxillary incisors. So the cross bite in the mandible is due to the palatally placed maxillary incisors. Since the maxillary incisors are inwards, so we are using Ketelin's appliance. And the Suede appliance, if you can see guys here, then Suede appliance is an upper inclined plane. Upper inclined plane, right? So if you can see here, there is acrylic which is placed on the upper anterior teeth, and also if you can see here, there is an incisal capping. So this incisal capping gives a reinforced anchorage, and in the reinforced anchorage, guys, we have also studied the example of reinforced anchorage. One of the example is the Suede appliance itself, right? So guys, this is the Suede appliance which was given by the Suede himself. So it covers the incisal edges of the anterior teeth, and basically it is used in a growing patient. And Suede appliance is our upper inclined plane, right? And the Ketelin's appliance is the lower inclined plane. So next one, guys, we have here, if you can see, is our finger spring. So guys, this is a finger spring, right, which is used to close the midline diastema. And finger spring, we also call it the single cantilever spring. So forces are applied. If you can see here, this part is going labially, and here is the palatal part. So single cantilever spring. Cantilever spring. Double cantilever spring is the Z spring that we are going to talk about. So single cantilever spring, which works on the reciprocal anchorage, which we have already covered in the anchorage part of the video. So finger spring is used to close the midline diastema, and this is finger spring is a single cantilever spring. If you can see here, the one in the diagram we have is the Z spring, as it is Z in shape. So this is Z in shape. This guys, this is our Z spring, right? So like this. So this is Z in shape. So this Z spring is the double cantilever spring. Double cantilever spring. And guys, if you can see here in the diagram, this is a lingually placed teeth. So in case of a lingually placed incisor, when we want this incisor to push labially, so this Z spring is going to put pressure like this, and it is going to make the labial movement of the incisor. So it can be used to move one or two incisors, and it is most commonly used in cases of anterior cross bite, along with if there is a posterior cross bite also. So it pushes the incisors forward by opening up these helices. If you can see here, if you can see, these are helixes. So these helix, they get closed, and it pushes these helices are opened, and once these helices start opening, so it pushes the incisors labially. So there is a labial movement of the incisors. So for rotation, we only use one helix is opened, and guys, both the spring we use for the labial movement of the incisors. So also we have the Denholz appliance, which is our upper lip bumper, which we have already covered, right? In the myofunctional appliances, that upper lip bumper we also call the Denholz appliance. And guys, Coffin spring, which we have studied in the slow maxillary expansion, right? So Coffin spring is, which is our omega shape wire, which is placed palatally, which is placed in the palatal region, and it is useful for the slow maxillary expansion. So it expands the both the lateral halves of the maxilla slowly by opening up the mid palatal suture, right? This also we have already covered. So it is activated by pulling both the sides, and it apparts both the sides of the palate by 1 to 2 millimeters, and therefore it opens up the palate. So it is also used in case of a constricted maxillary arch, or in case if there is a unilateral crossbite is present. So we also give the Coffin spring, and the spring was given by a person named Coffin. So Walter Coffin gave this Coffin spring. And guys, nowadays we have something known as the lingual orthodontics. Now lingual orthodontics is used for the people who are very much concerned with the aesthetics. So on those people we give the indirect bonding, which is placing the brackets on the lingual aspect of the teeth. So instead of placing the brackets labially, we are putting the brackets from inside so that the aesthetic is not hampered. Or also we have something like self ligating brackets. So these brackets have a build-up locking mechanism. So they are very hygienic, less time is taken for us to place these brackets. So there is no external ligation which is required to hold the wire onto the brackets. So examples of self-ligand brackets like Damon, Speed, Smart Clip brackets are self-ligand brackets. So guys, let's talk about the bonding and banding. So only three scientists. First we are going to talk about, one is the Bunocore. So Bunocore, we also know that associated with a composite and also acid etching. So acid etch technique was also given by Bunocore. And we are going to talk about Bowen. So Bowen give BIS GMA, and one more is the Newman. So he is the new guy here, Newman. So he developed bisphenol A, right? Now talking about the bonding procedures, first of all we'll be talking about the enamel etching, right? So etchant which we use for enamel etching is enamel etching. The etchant which we use is the 37% of orthophosphoric acid, right? But this orthophosphoric acid previously was tried in different percentage. So, and then they concluded that the 37% orthophosphoric acid is the correct concentration which is to be used, and most frequently asked in the questions also. So what if we use more than 50% of the phosphoric acid? So if we use more than 54% of the phosphoric acid, there is a formation of the mono calcium phosphate monohydrate. And this formation of the monocalcium phosphate monohydrate, it prevents for the dissolution of the enamel. So therefore, we should not use more than 50%. What if we use less than 27% of the orthophosphoric acid? If we use less than 27% of the orthophosphoric acid, then it forms dye. So it forms everything dye. Dye calcium, phosphate, dihydrate. Very easy, right? Dihydrate. So this, if we use less than 27%, it cannot be easily removed. So we do not use less than 27% of the percentage of the concentration of the phosphoric acid. So what is the correct percentage of the etchant which we use is the 37% of orthophosphoric acid for 15 to 20 seconds of time. This is the correct concentration and the correct time period. So what happens if we use this etchant, suppose this is the enamel surface. So what happens if we use this etchant? So there is a prismatic structure of the enamel, right? So there are rods which are present in the enamel surface. So we know that there are rods which are present. Let's make the rods also. So suppose this is the structure of the enamel. So what happens if we use etchant here? Let's make it from the different color, guys. So suppose if we use etchant here, what happens if we use etchant? So there are tags which are formed. So this is going to remove the smear layer. So this is the smear layer above this, guys. This layer supposes the smear layer. So what happens, it is going to remove the smear layer. So this etchant, it is going to remove the, let's try etchant here. So it is going to remove the smear layer. This is going to it's going to remove the smear layer. So let's make it like this. This etchant is going to remove the smear layer and it is going to make the tags in the enamels. So these tags are the micro tags or the macro tags, like this. So this is what it does, this etchant does to the enamel layer. So it is going to remove the tags. It is going to make these tags. So if we study the type of the acid etching, we have got the types of the acid etching, right? First type, or the type one we have, is the one with the honeycomb appearance. Because there is, see, suppose these are the pattern which are formed. So this is the, after using the etchant, so we have kind of this pattern. There are loss of enamel prisms at the centers. So to be exact, we should draw something like this. So there are honeycomb like patterns, because from the inside there is a loss of enamel prisms. So from the center, suppose, guys, this one, right? How honeycomb appearance? Because there is, it is very difficult, guys, with this. Okay, so from the center there is loss. Now if you can see here, so like this, there is a honeycomb like appearance because there is a loss of enamel prisms from the center. So the first one is the honeycomb appearance, right? Honeycomb appearance. Second one, guys, type is the cobblestone appearance. So now there is a dissolution of enamel from the center. Now the enamel will start dissolving from the periphery also. So cobblestone appearance. So the enamel will become like this from the peripheries also. So like this. This is a cobblestone appearance, because there is a dissolution of the enamel at the periphery. So let's write dissolution at the periphery. And the third one, third type, is map-like appearance. So third type is map-like appearance. Map-like appearance. How this map-like appearance? Because there are pitted enamels. So it appears like a map. The fourth one, guys, is there are several holes which are formed. So there is a granulation of the enamel with the holes, with several holes. So how much of this tags or this layer is formed? Smear layer is formed, right? We know that. So how long is this formed? So it is somewhere around 10 micrometers depth. So this hole, or I mean approximately 10 micrometers. So if you talk about range, it is 5 to 50 micrometers. So this is the depth of these tags which are formed due to the 37% phosphoric acid of the enamel etching. Okay guys, next one we are going to talk about the generations of the bonding agents. So we'll be talking about the hiding points. So generations of bonding agents. We have the first generation bonding agent, which mainly is due to the chelation, right? So bonds calcium, it binds to the calcium of the tooth. So initially there was no concept of bonding agent, there was no concept of acid etching, there was no concept of applying adhesive. So there was a system which used to work. Initially the first system was the chelation. That means, suppose this is a metal, so when it binds to the organic, so that is the bond which is formed, is the chelation, right? So guys, first one we have is the silane coupling agents. Silane coupling agents. So that is NPG, GMA, or cyanoacrylates, polyurethanes, like that. Second generation is formation of the ionic bond. So we know that in the dentine there is calcium which is present, and this calcium makes a bond, right? So there is a formation of chlorophosphate. So also in the second generation there is no concept of the acid etching, so there is a non-etched. So we have like NPG, GMA, and we have phenyl P, then we have like that. Talking about the third generation is not exactly the removal of smear layer. So we know that there is a presence of smear layer, and below that there are enamel tags, right? That we have discussed just now. So we know that there is a formation of, first of all, there is a removal of smear layer. So what we have talked about is, first of all, there is a removal of the smear layer. Then we have studied that there are tags which are formed. So in this case, there is a partial removal of the tags. So not exactly complete removal of the tags. So what happens, suppose if there is complete removal is up till here. So there is no complete removal, there is a partial removal of the smear layer, is what do we call the modified. So there is a modification of the smear layer in the third generation. So there is an introduction of the concept of removing the smear layer, but without disturbing the plugs. So without disturbing the plugs that are going into the dentinal tubules. So there is only the introduction of the removal of the smear layer in case of the third generation. So third generation, there is introduction of the three steps, right? So the three steps, which is the etchant, primer, adhesive, like that. So there is only partial removal, not complete removal. Then we have the fourth generation. So guys, the fourth generation is the complete removal of the smear layer. Is the complete removal of the smear layer. which is very important. So we have three bottle system. One is the etchant, which is our 37% phosphoric acid, orthophosphoric acid, right? Which we have just now talked about, that if it is more than 50%, it forms the monocalcium phosphate monohydrate. And if it is less than 27%, then it forms the dicalcium phosphate dihydrate. Also, three bottle, right? One, there is etchant, then the primer, and the primer is our NTG GMA, or it can be HEMA. Or the third one is the adhesive. So, adhesive. But remember that it is a complete removal of the smear layer in the fourth generation, which we must remember. So, this is the fourth generation. So, adhesive, we have the etchant primer as well as adhesive, which is again Bis GMA or Tegma, it can be, right? Or Tegma. So, there is complete removal of the smear layer. We know that there is a formation of hybrid layer. So, that all we are going to talk about when we are studying the dental materials. Talking about, guys, the fifth generation. So, fifth generation, there is etchant plus there is a bottle which contains the bonding, the primer, that means the bonding agent. So, this is a bonding agent, which is the primer plus adhesive. So, this is fifth generation, is what do we call the total etch. Total etch generation. So, the etchant we have is the, of course, orthophosphoric acid. Orthophosphoric acid. And the bottle which contains the primer and adhesive solvent. So, that is penta, or that can be methacrylates, phosphonates. Phosphonates. So, this is the fifth generation, which is one bottle which contains the bonding agent, another bottle which is the etchant. So, we have next generation, which is the sixth generation, guys. So, sixth generation we have is the self-etch adhesive. Self-etching adhesives. That means we have adhesive separately. So, adhesive we have separately. So, this is the adhesive. And let's write A. And we have etchant plus primer in one bottle. Right. So, this is self-etching adhesive. So, the sixth generation we have acid plus primer in one bottle, which is our methacrylated phosphonates. So, guys, this is the sixth generation. Now, in the sixth generation, the main benefit is that every time after etching, we have to rinse, right? We have to rinse with the water. So, we don't have to do this in case of sixth generation. So, sixth generation is our self-etching adhesive. Then we have got the seventh generation, guys. So, the seventh generation is our all-in-one bottle. Everything in one bottle. So, we have etchant plus primer plus adhesive in one bottle. So, this is all in one bottle. So, guys, this was about the bonding. What about debonding? We have to remove after the orthodontic treatment. Definitely, we have to remove all the brackets from the teeth, right? So, it is much easier to remove the metal brackets. Because ceramic, we know that it is a brittle metal. So, ceramic, we have studied that all. That means it is a brittle material. So, all the brittle materials like ceramic, right? So, this ceramic, because we know it is a brittle material, once we try to separate the ceramic bracket, it breaks in pieces. So to debond, it is much easier for the metal bracket, easier than the ceramic brackets. And for metal bracket, we can use debonding pliers. For ceramic brackets, we can also use the thermal debonding, or we can also use the laser. But once you remove the composite, see, once you remove the bracket, so there is little bit of composite. Suppose this is a tooth surface, right? Earlier, guys, we had a bracket here. This is a bracket. And this bracket, between the tooth and the bracket, we had a composite. So once we remove this bracket, so there is a composite which is left, right? So there is a composite which is left, residual composite, which is there on the tooth surface. So we remove this with the help of a carbide burr, which is a 12 fluted tungsten carbide burr. Tungsten carbide burr. So this burr, we use it to remove the rest of the composite which is present on the tooth surface. And you know, the best part about this burr is that it only removes the adhesive. It doesn't cut the enamel surface. So we use this burr. So ceramic brackets, they have a high risk of enamel damage if we compare it with a metal bracket. So guys, let's quickly talk about the banding also, the bands. So banding, we are going to talk only about the sizes of the bands. So we use different thickness of the band for anterior tooth or for posterior. Oh, okay, we know that the band which we use are the stainless steel bands, right? And the band which we use in the anterior teeth are different. The anterior teeth, we use the thin bands. For posterior teeth, we use a thick band. So it is very easy for us to remember, right? Now let's start from the incisor teeth, incisors. So here we are going to write the thickness of the band, and here we are going to write the width of the band. So width, we know that is going to be increasing as we go from anterior to posterior teeth. Also the thickness will increase. So thickness is very easy. So anterior teeth, the thickness remains the same, which is the 0.003 inches, 0.003 inches, for both incisors and canine, right? And for premolars and molars, it is different. So premolar, a little bit thick, that is 0.004 inches, and for molar it is 0.005 inches. Very easy. And width also, we have to go on in the increasing order. So incisors, the width of the band which we use is 0.125 inches, then 0.150 inches, then again 0.150 inches. So for premolar, for canine and premolar, the width is same. For incisors and canine, the thickness is same. And for molars, we use 0.180 inches. So guys, this is about the banding and the bonding, and this video also we have talked about the removal and the only the key points of the removal and the fixed orthodontics. So guys, if you have enjoyed the video, then give it a thumbs up. Also, you can comment in the comment section below, because it motivates me to put more videos like this, more free videos for you. And you don't have to take down notes. You have to check out the link in the description box below for the notes. And if you're looking for more interesting notes, you can also check out on our website, www.x2.com. And now you can support us on Paytm as well as on PayPal to make free videos like this. So to make free courses for you guys. So guys, till then, keep reading, keep learning, stay motivated. I'll see you soon in the next video.